Just a little bit about the Dramatists. We're a 62-year-old organization. Our mission is we're dedicated to the playwrights. So we provide time and space for writers to create. We give them 7-year residencies. We don't charge them anything. We have 3 different spaces. This is one of the spaces. So not only do we do readings and workshops for the writers, but we also host events like this, forums like this. So I do want to thank Michael Hollinger, who is an alum of the Dramatists and a colleague of Harry and Bob. And so that's how this happened today. And we're thrilled to have, let me just introduce the panelists to you. Harry Power, Robert Hedley, Torben Betts, and Anthony Way are our panelists. We're going to do a big thank you to Villanova University, TCG, and of course to Michael Hollinger. I should let you know that with the permission of the participants, I'm actually going to read this, this forum is being live streamed on the internet through New Play TV. So any questions you might ask will be broadcast as part of the live stream. So thank you for that. And I think the only other thing I need to say is please turn off your phones and any other electronic devices. And without further ado, this is over here, a forum on new play development and production.
Hi, thanks for coming out tonight. Great to see all of you here. And don't be dismayed if there are people walking in. There are a lot of people who got on the list, want to be here, and we hope they will be. But anyway, we need to start so we can get home before it snows or whatever else it's doing. I think what we're going to do tonight, first of all, we'd like to see this as a discussion, and hopefully some of you have experience with American developmental programs, theaters, etc. We'll talk mainly about the British experience and an article. I don't. John, did. Were there? Oh, they're there. There are copies of American Theater that have been donated. So if you didn't get your December issue, which has our article about this, there's some there. Please take them, and it's a great magazine, and we're delighted to be in it. So I think what we'll do, just programmatically, so we all understand how this is going to run. Harriet will just talk about the findings vis-a-vis the article. I'm going to talk a little more broadly and bore you with some statistics about new writing, and then we'll turn it over to the exciting folks, Torben Betts and Anthony Way, who talk about their own experience in the UK in sort of developmental situations and just how they came to be successfully produced writers. So, Harriet, if you
first, I wanted to ask, I recognize some writers in the audience because I'm thrilled to see old friends, but would you mind raising your hand if you define yourself as a writer, playwright? Remember, it's going to be particularly important to hear from you because it's finally all about you. This is, our art form revolves around you, even though it often seems like it doesn't. It's interesting to be a new dramatist because I feel like we're with Corbin and Anthony, and the four of us are here, partly because of Todd London. Todd London, in collaboration with others, wrote the book Outrageous Fortune, The Life and Times of the American Playwright. And both Bob and I were galvanized and upset by the book. And I know that there were controversies, which I think were generated. It's a perspective about a particular time in our country, but because both of our theater lives are focused so much, as directors in Bob's case, and playwright, teacher, and mentor, on new writing, the idea that the playwright in this country typically struggled terribly to make any money at all, really gripped us. And when we had dual sabbaticals from the other part of our lives, our university lives, down the University of Villanova, we wanted to go to London and look at the new play culture over there and see if there was anything we might learn. See if the Brits did anything we did not, that would be worth thinking about doing. We saw 62 new plays in 5 months. We got to meet both Anthony and Torben. And they were two of 40 artists, largely writers and also literary managers and artistic directors, some actors, some dramaturgs. Perhaps it was our good luck, but out of 62 new plays in 5 months, I would say 15 of them were fabulous, and only about 3 of them were not good at all. And so that was a lot of stimulation, and it made us curious, was this a fluky 5 months? What fed that ecology? And the article talks about some of that, so I don't want to necessarily repeat it, but I guess one of the thrilling outcomes of Outrageous Fortune is that more theaters now have playwrights on staff in paid positions with health insurance. That's a big deal. The fact that health insurance is for people in the UK right there was a stunning humiliating for me as an American, and powerful difference. And perhaps we're looking at the cusp of a little bit of change in this country. Certainly that's something we can't readily copy, but not having to worry about that as we do. There's someone in the audience I won't name who didn't see a dentist for a good deal of a very fruitful career. There simply wasn't the money. I'm carefully looking down so I don't identify the person, but I know the person knows who the person. That's a crazy circumstance. Here we are in Manhattan, where we spent a lot of time and Bob used to live. And yet, every day, on every block, in every bus, on every in every tube station, everywhere we went, the degree of diversity in London was staggering. We heard 8 or 10 languages speak different. Day after day after day. And it was interesting that the WASP culture, white Anglo-Saxon Protestant, this is a completely new city to me, someone who's been there on and off all my life. And it feels that there's an appetite for stories about other cultures. Now, for two white males, that privileging of other voices may at times feel frustrating, and we'll hear from you, I hope. But it was interesting to us how many writers of color, writers of other cultures, women were on the stages, and how diverse the audiences were there. And it felt like, as we spoke to people, this is a country widely described as anxious to have a national dialogue with itself, and seeing the theater is the primary form for doing that. Exciting. There were, I actually told Torben, who I just saw last night, just landed on our shores, his relatively new play is getting its second ever production, Muswell Hill, at Villanova University. I have the great privilege of directing it. I think this is our contemporary check-off. I want everybody to know the play and to know it. But I said, you wouldn't be here if not for the fact that Britain does something I wish we could figure out how to do. Which is, and if you've been there, you know this, that when you leave the theater having seen a new play, you can buy the script. And in a nicely bound version. And had I not been able to buy his play, put it aside, read it 2 months later, and realize, yes, this really speaks to me, we would be here. And I wish we could figure out how to do that. It seems so basic. And all the writers we talked to said, the fact that my play remains in circulation means, at the very least, it's taught in schools. People can find it, people can resurrect it. That's enormous. As odd as this sounds, the other thing that struck us is it didn't matter what size theater, every theater in London has a bar, a lounge, food. You can bring the food in, you can bring the wine in, you can bring the beer in, and these theaters were packed. before and after with people who see them as places to be and to be in conversation. And that felt, well, it just felt terribly envious of it. And it seemed, this isn't so difficult to do. And of course, there are many theaters that have that. But that was very powerful, the idea, and the fact that you could actually take your drinks into theaters was fascinating to us. And I kept wondering, is somebody going to slurp in the middle of a major moment? But it never happened. Somewhere it all worked out. And that also felt powerful. So whether we're talking about it, okay, I guess the last thing I might say is that Arts Council England supplies a lot of money relative to our national funding. I know, it makes you laugh. There's, what choice do we have? We're going to either laugh or weep. And there's no question that at some point tonight, the notion of if you had the magic wand, what would you do in order to support the writer? Sadly, money seems to enter in. I think there's no way around that. Arts Council England is looking at major cuts, and this is putting a lot of theaters on notice. And it will be interesting to see how they cope. So that's a little snapshot of 5 rolling months of into the prison life.
As well as reading Outrageous Fortune and hearing Todd Ellman speak, I've had a number of students who, former students who've had plays produced, and it was curious to me why, say, Naomi Wallace, Rebecca Gilman, who were both former students, why could they get production so easily and were better known in London than, well, maybe not Naomi Wallace, perhaps not, but certainly Rebecca Gilman, although she's had a Broadway show and she's sort of known here, why was she so well known over there? We went to RADA to do some workshops and that sort of thing, and when I said to a person who works with writers and actors, well, you know, he said, well, do you know any writers here? And I said, well, gee, these, you know, former students of mine said, well, Rebecca Gilman, you know, Naomi Wallace. Now, I don't say that. It's the writers that may come through your program or something like that. This is largely accidental, and we're delighted whoever they are. However, what was interesting to me was how well-known American writers were there. And we did a survey with the people we interviewed, and we asked them to suggest the top 3 British writers they really thought were maybe the next coming writers, the next top writers, etc. In the 40 people, we got 29 different people, supposedly the top writers in London. Now, considering our small sample, that was a large number. I mean, if you queried people here, you'd probably get 70 or 80. I mean, this is not to say at all that there aren't tremendous writers here. There are, and they're often well known. But still, it seemed, I wouldn't say easy, but easier for those American writers to get productions there, not readings, but actual productions. So that was another reason that we had to try and look into this and to ask ourselves, having worked with writers really all our lives, what was different about the way that productions were mounted or plays were taken and seemingly so quickly got produced, that there wasn't these long waiting periods when you're getting endless readings and everybody and his brother is telling you how to rewrite, but really quickly getting up. Harriet mentions Art Council England. I thought, you know, I might just scare you with this, thinking that I was going to read it. And I decided not to. About 120 pages. This is a study, one of many studies, that was funded by Arts Council of England to look at playwriting across the country, not just in London, but across the country. It's an exhaustive study, and while all of these studies, including Outrageous Fortune, you can always look at that and say, well, why wasn't this person consulted, or why wasn't that theater included? You can do that, and that's legitimate. They interviewed, I didn't count how many, but there are pages of people they interviewed for this study. And the general conclusions are that of the number of plays being done now in the UK, about 67% are new plays. Of that number, about 17% are adaptations, in other words, new versions of plays. The box office receipts, there is virtually, you think in this country that new plays very often are relegated to small theaters. Because as the common wisdom is, if you do a new play, it's liable to sink your theater because you won't make any money. However, what the study points out is in the UK, there are as many plays produced at large stages with fairly large audiences, 200 plus audiences, as there are in small theaters. The box office receipts from new plays are as great or greater than revivals, etc., excluding Shakespeare. So the report sort of puts to the lie two things. One, that new plays will sink your theater and you won't make any money. Statistically, that's been shown by these exhaustive studies that that's not the actual case when you talk to the theaters and ask them how much they made, what, etc. Secondly, that audience numbers are just as great for new work as they are for revivals, and that is including Shakespeare. Overall, when the study looks at the UK overall, the place of playwriting is not only promising, but in fact is the dominant mode. Again, excluding Shakespeare. Because that's not any of the tourists, so we know that. If you talk to individual writers, however, about these statistics, most of the individual writers have almost the same complaints as writers do in this country. Probably foremost is, how do you get a second production? And if your play is done in a small theater in London, will it ever get another production, particularly in a larger theater? That's a worry. And there is a worry among individual writers that the young writers are really sort of pushing out the old writer, or middle age, or mature, or established people, that there's such a premium on young writers, and secondly, that there's a fair premium on diverse voices. Now, that's terrific. Women writers, well, women writers are not doing quite as well as they have 4 or 5 years ago, but they are, in fact, major contributors to the writing scene in the UK. However, the emerging writers, the minority writers, etc., this is a growing, and in the view of some writers, at least, the privileged group. There's a small theater, I'm not sure whether either of you guys know this theater, but it's the Angle Theater. And the Angle Theater, they're very interested in outreach. And recently, this is 2 years ago, they handed out in their particular neighborhood 30,000 pamphlets that asked if you, have you ever considered writing a play? Would you like somebody to read your play? They pinned these up in laundromats, in restaurants, in everywhere they could find, and they routinely do these plays. Now, I saw two, and quite frankly, they were quite awful. But both of them, you know, when you read the life story of the writer says, you know, I work in this, I don't know, grocery store. I've never written anything in my life. And when I saw this, I thought, yes, I have a story to tell. And so I wrote the play. Now, because the plays weren't particularly finished, doesn't mean anything more than the amount of time spent with them was very short. They had, you know, a lot of passion, a lot of ideas, and presumably in the future, they might indeed become writers, who knows. But the notion in a neighborhood, which is primarily a neighborhood of minorities, it was terrific to encourage those people into the theaters. Now, London, compared to, say, the size and, well, simply the size of the US, is of course tiny. And we were talking about the fact that there is such a concentration of artists of every sort in London that, in most ways, that's an unfair picture of the whole country. And certainly, compared to the US, where at my last count, there's about 15 or 16 developmental places like this across the country, not including developmental workshops, etc., connected with theaters. Most of the reputable theaters have what they would describe as a developmental workshop, as you know. So, comparing the London culture to this vast landscape, where, you know, we were, I was talking to Torben about like how many playwriting programs, and immediately you could say, well, you could start at 100 programs that actually turn out playwrights. And then from 100, you begin adding these additional ones that you find. But so, in other words, every year in this country, the universities are turning out maybe 200 writers every year. And that number is pushing the available spaces and how many possibilities there are for production in the US. I mean, it's, the numbers are staggering. Now, a little different, though, in London, because now we looked at most of the theaters that do developmental productions. And There's about, I would say, 15 at most that really do this work. And those 15 then can call on wonderful directors, designers, actors to get the work done. And you go into a small theater and, you know, in most cases, if you're outside New York, say, you go into a small theater and you sort of expect, wrongly often, that the quality of production will be less somehow. However, it's not at all true in London. The quality will normally be very high. And so we look at, we spent an awful lot of time just asking ourselves questions about this. What's happening there versus what's happening here? And it's not that there are better writers or anything like that. It certainly helps, as Harriet suggests, it helps that there's so much publication. Four major publishers, and every play that gets produced at a reasonable size theater is going to be published. Somebody is going to publish it. And that, of course, keeps plays in some kind of circulation, even if the next production of that play is going to be in some other city outside London. So we'll return to some of these larger issues in a bit, but let's turn now and hear from these two writers about their personal experiences in the theater there. And they sort of open up and talk about American process and what's going on here. Torben, do you want to start?
My experience is probably not typical. I started off as an actor and wasn't getting anywhere, so I thought I'll do something else. So I started writing plays, and in one when I was about 26, I wrote four plays in about a year and a half. One in the rhyming couplets, one which was a kind of absurdist, pastiche, and another two which were sort of boring and dark comedies of manners rather than what you're doing now. Set them all off, was met with a deafening silence, which was very dispiriting, because I decided I was going to give up acting and now I'm not going to be a playwright, what the hell am I going to do? Then, after about a year, the rejection letters started coming in, some of them very brutal. The Royal Court, particularly nasty. National. I basically sent three plays off to every single new writing theatre in England and got precisely nowhere. And as I say, there's some of the rejection letters were fairly grim. So I thought, I'm going to leave the country in a bit of peak, do some teaching, and work out what the hell to do with my life. I felt quite lost, I have to say. And then as I was about to leave, I got a letter from Alan Ayckbourn's theatre. Alan Ayckbourn, he basically really liked one of the plays, which is the one that had been particularly slaughtered by all of the literary departments. And I was stuck out a little bit vindicated. When I came back, I'd already committed to teaching for 6 months. I came back. I met up with Alan Ayckbourn and his literary manager, and he said, yeah, we think this play is great, we might need to do a bit of work on it, but we definitely like to produce this play. And I went, thanks very much. I went back to do a terrible job in an office, waiting for the phone call from Alan to change my life and have a play on, and it didn't come. A year passed, and another year kept going. I was still writing plays, because they'd encouraged me, they were foolish enough to encourage me. Another 2 years went by, nothing happened. I phoned him, his surgeon, and said, you've forgotten about me. He said, oh, no, we want you to be writing residence. And then I went to be writing residence at Alan's Theatre in Scarborough, where I finally get my first play produced. So to get my first professional production, I think I was 31. It was a long, long time, and it was grim. But then things started to move on. And then I came back to London and did quite a lot of plays that had also been slaughtered by these literary departments, were then produced largely by actors for nothing. Got a group of actors together and we did them in sort of fringe theatres, which were actually did very well and got sort of time out to pretty short, but there was no money involved, which were probably the happiest experiences of my life as a theatre writer, and people just coming together, doing it, wanting to do it with no strings attached. So in terms of how my plays developed, I haven't really had that experience. Alan Aitborn suggested to me how to improve that first play, and I didn't take his advice, but his advice obviously, he knew what he was talking about with structure. But in terms of actually getting into a, Anthony will probably know better than I will, about being in a building and having a few managers working with you on play development, I really have very little experience of that. It's either been my last play, Boswell Hill, which was on the Orange Tree. I basically only just finished writing it, and the artistic director just wanted to put it on, so I was actually rewriting it during rehearsals because I was taken aback by the fact that he wanted to do it so quickly. Normally it takes, a lot of your writers years and years and years before the play actually goes on. So my experience has probably not been typical, but other writers who are more in the, are embraced more in the, by particularly London theatres. I've been always felt slightly out of the cold, but I still persevere. So that sums up my experience.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's such a huge area.
Yes.
When I think about this fantastic article, I think about I think a lot of the reason for the, in a way, I take kind of a big picture of a renaissance in British new writing can be isolated to the uptick in funding that occurred in the mid-90s in the United Kingdom. And that's when theatre companies developed into departments and literary managers, and there was a huge resurgence of British new writing, particularly in the regions. Writers like Sarah Kane all came from this time. Anthony Nielsen, to speak really, really briefly about my experience, I did something that's not usual in the UK. There are not any real MA programs in playwriting. In a way, Torben's experience is very true, I think, to certainly my colleagues who are playwrights in the UK. Is that for write plays, theatres work more. You don't tend to go to university and study playwriting. There are three courses that I know of, that the first course, and possibly the first course, of course, established by English playwright David Edgar at the University of Birmingham, around about time when I was speaking. And I went, did my master's at that course. I'm originally Australian. And from there, however, my journey was largely similar. I wrote a couple of plays. I wrote a series of nasty rejection rates, probably from the same people. And then I wrote more like them. And some of the National Theatre said, come and have a chat. I came and have a chat. The National Theatre got this body called Studio, where it's an off-site building, where they give you 8 weeks, small subsistence wage, and say, knock yourself out, right? And so I wrote a play. And then they got this play into the hands of a young, hungry artistic director at a little theatre bar pub in London called Bush. Bush is a powerhouse of the UK. And this young director, Joseph Walker, said, right, I'll do the play. And from the time of me, of her reading the play, to the production, I think it was maybe 4 months. And there's a, there's a flexibility in the way theatre's program in the United Kingdom, which enables this in general to happen. I became associate playwright at the theatre. The National Theatre invited me to become part of residence in 2009, which is, so I spent a year there. And from there, you know, my career took off in similar productions. My work, more than one production of my work, I'm published by Paper and Paper, and so the thing that Harriet's speaking about certainly to remind us. Companies here, companies in Australia, you know, do my work, of course, they can get hold of the physical text, which I think sort of helps. I'm currently associate artist at the Dom Warehouse, which is a theatre in London's West End, which produces plays there and also tours internationally from time to time. And I'm currently here in New York as an adjunct professor and playwright at the Graduate School of the Arts at Columbia University. That's kind of a potted story about me. But in terms of my experience of being here tonight to talk about, which is new play development, I think the real key is that the development is short, sharp, clear, and you get a production. Now, that's not always the case, and you can find lots of, I can examples to disagree with that rule. But in general, speaking from my experience, companies like the Bush, like the Dolma, directors reach a play, they like it, they really like it, they say they do it in a way that they're making it, you know, brand new. That's generally my experience. The idea of development is a kind of a shyness about development. The directors that I know certainly, I think, chime with the idea that the best development that they can give a play and a playwright is to put the thing on. There's all sorts of economics that surround that in the UK that this don't happen. The substance supports that type of activity enormously. The lack of the commercial imperatives. In my first play, was a play for maybe 15 people, about 7 or 8, and it was done in a theatre above a pub in West London. There weren't these types of driving economics to create production.
We'll come back to that. One of the things we probably should suggest, at least, Arts Council of England, although there have been cuts, and undoubtedly everybody is threatening cuts in the future, nonetheless, the notion that you have an Arts Council, and the Arts Council funded this 120-page study of theater, because there was some concern that that new writers weren't being encouraged because there was a premium being placed on various kind of concocted theatrical evenings and that sort of thing. And then some studies were done just to find out what the state of playwriting was. And this is enormously helpful that there is an agency that at least wants to test the waters, find out, in fact, what's really going on as much as you ever can. And to bring to the general public an understanding of the arts, because in England, at least, and never mind the rest of the UK, but in England, such a large part of commerce, etc., is around the theatrical industry. So many jobs, say, so much merchandising is done in and around the theater so that studies are easier to justify in this broad way and find out what's actually happening. And have some government intervention vis-a-vis, or by way of funding, what funding is and what funding ought to be. And so the notion of looking at your country and wondering how culture is doing as a government activity, enormously important. Now, depending on how the government drifts, you might say, ooh, that's a terror, that's difficult. But just to be able to test the waters of where the culture is, where it's going, that kind of thing, is, I think, enormously helpful. So there are a lot of studies that we looked at in the course of writing an article for American Theater, just to see how things were going and what how writers were being, say, privileged within the culture, how writers were indeed just being treated in the culture. We were interested in looking at that because while there's lots of advantages to a hands-off approach, as this country largely is, nonetheless, to look and see what, how things could be better here by the adoption of programs that might, in some minor way at least, replicate what goes on in other places where theater is a high point of people's experience. And the second thing was, I want to just mention, we made friendships with a number of families over there, and just sort of interesting to try and, in a very small way, with a very, very small sample, find out how deeply embedded, say, theater was in the culture, to talk about how plays were received, etc. Well, it was so shocking to us that there were so many knowledgeable people outside the theater who felt they had a stake in what the theater was, and particularly what it was in. In a different way than if you're in New York, I mean, everybody seems to be attached to the theater in some manner, but there, much more of the average folk seem to be enormously interested in what's going on in the theater, and therefore pressure can be applied to governments, etc., to make sure that funding, when there was a sort of an initiative to cut funding, I think this is like 3 years ago, something like that, the outcry was so tremendous that, yes, there were still cuts, but they weren't as draconian as it was thought that they might be. The culture then really comes from a long, long tradition in supporting live theater. That's not necessarily our culture, but it certainly is, it seems to be at least the culture in New York. Thoughts on that, Eric?
Well, it can feel a little discouraging. I've adopted, I think, I remember a family of non-artists who we happened to meet talking about the fact that they really weren't, they didn't ever go to Shakespeare. they've seen plenty of Shakespeare, so they made a point of going to new plays, new plays. And you know, you just sort of, you know, I don't want to say, breathe on me and let me spread my, let me spread your DNA around. I guess now that we're back, I don't find it very productive to wish that how they do things there happens here. Although I do feel that I would like to join forces with anyone and everyone who could help make published versions of plays that were in their premieres available. I mean, I want to put it out there. I want to do that. I don't know if it's possible to do that. I mean, I might point to you and just ask, is that impossible here and why? Why? If it is.
Is there a bookstore left in New York besides the Drama Bookshop?
Well,
that's a good question.
Yes.
Yes. We also do have Soho Rep, our Playwrights Horizons, and they will publish the plays that they're doing.
Right, so that there are happy exceptions to that pact. Yes, and actually we were recently there, and we were thinking, gosh, isn't this terrific? I can get a number of the plays.
Also, I'm just thinking, if you know about Chino Nights, the Daniel Talbots with Rising Phoenix Theater, where they put on a whole play in a week, they produce it, but the publisher for their anthology is the New York Theater Experience, Inc., and they have a series, a whole bunch of independent plays that they publish there. So it seems like there's actually...
There are grassroots. It's happening.
Yeah, and it seems like it's more possible if we look digitally than anything.
Right.
I mean, if I had a play produced and somebody wanted to read it, I would just gladly send them a PDF of it, you know. So I would just make that known even on a program, just from a playwright's perspective.
Right, it makes sense.
Writing,
writing, writing, writing,
producing house, and hope for the best. Is it exactly the same
in the United States?
Yeah, yeah. I'm just a little curious what that journey is.
Well, we have a lot of writers here, and I think the people best positioned to answer the question, I'm an American playwright, what's the journey of getting my play done? I want to invite writers to talk about it. I mean, I will say that Outrageous Fortune, God Love and Another's book, however accurately, it certainly seemed to reflect the experience of many writers I knew, my own experience as a director of the work and the development of dramaturgy, that many writers get invited to do readings or stage readings, and they don't go beyond that stage. And so there's a little bit of a spin cycle that never yields the output. But there are a number of playwrights here. Does anyone want to speak to that? And there are people here in the position of nurturing plays. It would be wonderful to hear.
Well, it seems to me, as a playwright, that one of the shoots that you have to fly through is getting the script read, and is getting the script read by the right person, because very often you don't know who's on the staff and who's throwing things into the wastebasket. And finding somebody who knows somebody who will be able to deliver that script to that person, I think is enormously valuable. Even then, it isn't necessarily that you will have a result, but at least you know it was read, and you know by whom it was read. And it wasn't an MFA student somewhere, you know, getting credits by reading for the public or whatever it is. So that seems crucial. And I've also had the experience in sending things to some of the London theaters. They don't seem to set up as many roadblocks to getting read. So I have my rejection from the Royal Court, okay? And I have my rejection from the National Studio and so on, and they actually get through, and it can take months, but you have a specific critique that is sent back to you so that you have some sense of where you stand. And that's that just, to me, sharpens the difference between trying to get that done here and getting it done in London.
When I was writing the residency at the National, one of my jobs was to sit on that theater's meeting panel. And we noticed that the CVs of American playwrights, which we received among the players, we're glad for, were extremely long. And the CVs of the British counterparts, their colleagues in Britain, were very short. And it didn't take long to work out. The reason why the CVs were so long is because they annotated the enormous number of development processes that each player had gone through. Workshops, readings, summer residencies, all of which I'm sure terrifically useful. But it was very difficult to find a production. Sad. Whereas in the UK, playwrights, there seem to be many more productions. Just anecdotal, my friends here, the playwrights here, will say, I'm casting, we're in casting. I'm like, oh, fantastic, great, when's it going on? I'm like, oh, this is for the reading. And I'm like, okay, that's, you know. So I just think that's helpful. I think anecdotally, I think that that's kind of, it bears out what you're saying.
As well, when I was verging on being kind of bitter about what was happening to me, playwrights, we're never far away from bitterness. But when I wasn't getting, there was two plays on, and I wasn't getting on, and they've been rejected, I just, as I mentioned, did them with the director and actors, got them on in other theatres, got quite good reviews, and the literary manager at the National since had said, oh yeah, Torben squandered his career by putting his own plays on in these pub theatres, no one's going to take them seriously. Whereas for me, that was those are the experiences which made me know my worth. You know, put it in front of an audience. If I hadn't put those plays in front of an audience, I'd never have known that I would be a playwright. So it spawned my career, but it also gave me, the realization that I wasn't wasting my life, which is, again, another thing that playwrights need to feel from time to time. So it's difficult.
Yeah, I think I'll throw a few bombs in the room and see how they land. May I? I'm Anne. Hey, Tony, over from Lincoln Center. I think that I was reading the article in the Times this morning about the editor's comments on Betty Friedan's book, mm-hmm. The Feminine Mystique.
Yes.
And I thought, in a way, that's the best thing that could have happened. If everyone had liked your play, it would have been the end of theater. There should be someone who loved your play. Maybe it was you, and it was the director and the actors who went for it. The worst thing that can happen is that everyone loves the same 10 writers, and that's all that you ever see is the same 10 writers. I do believe that most things are driven by economics. When we all started in the theater, there were statistics made that 5% of the American population, this is probably 1969, 70 when the NEA was founded, 5% of the American population had ever been in a theater. We're not a population of educated people, we're a population of immigrants. So when the Ford Foundation money started those theaters around the country, the Taper, the Arena, the Alley, everywhere, it was introducing theater that other than touring Broadway shows and Dusa, and those people who'd been to Leadville and San Francisco, which was founded by the revolutionaries from 1848, so that was always an exception, had never seen before. So that's only 50 or 60 years ago. People like Adrian Hall, who founded Trinity Rapids and Dallas Theater Center, ran that for many years. When he founded Trinity Rep, he started an education program where every student of the state of Rhode Island, okay, it's a small state, saw three productions at Trinity Rep every year they were in high school. So by the time every student of that state finished high school, they'd seen 12 plays. And that alone takes care of, well, I don't have to say any more about that. So I don't have to remind you that the highest level of funding for the NEA was under Nancy Hanks, who worked for Richard Nixon. There's no question about it. That was the biggest amount of pie that was ever put into the arts. That's why that building is named after her. I don't have to tell you what's happened to funding for education and theater in this country. I mean, I'm not talking about highly expensive graduate programs. I'm talking about school children who go to theater. It doesn't exist. And the level of government funding doesn't exist. One of the reasons that you're seeing what you're seeing is because the theaters, I was on a panel with my friend who has my job at the Comédie Française, a theater of equal size to Lincoln Center Theater, and every year at 5 minutes after midnight on January 1st, they get 99.8% of their funding and a check from the government. Lincoln Center Theater gets 0.2% of its operating budget, all federal, state, and city sources combined. That's good. I've been dealing with the Alexandrinsky Theater in St. Petersburg right now, a fabulously glamorous, large theater, and they can't put on their developmental program in April because the government hasn't released their money. So I wrote them today and said, that's a great asset of capitalism is when you have no money and you raise it, at least you can spend it whenever you want. So I think that I know that all of you who know theaters well know that to apply for a grant, to apply to a foundation, to apply for any corporate money, certainly to apply to what's left of the NEA or NISCA, you have to write what you're doing in 2 years. You cannot just suddenly announce what you're doing. We're probably the only theater that doesn't have a season. We don't have a subscription. We can say what we're doing in a month from now because we have a certain cushion. So I think a lot of this inflexibility, the reason that you're seeing the same plays done over and over is because when you say for an application to a grant, we're going to be doing other desert cities, you can put the reviews in. And you know, when we started, there was an absolutely regional character to new play work in this country. There was the Chicago School of Writers. There was, you created the Philadelphia School of Writers. There was this Bay Area School of Writers. I'm talking about Mamet, Shepard, you know, Tina, Irene, what she was doing at 42nd Street, Steve Carter was doing at the NEC. And all of that, you know, there was the, I used to work at the Northwest Playwrights Festival, which were just playwrights from Idaho, Washington, Oregon, because I grew up out there. Now there's very much of a uniformity. And I think a lot of that comes from just the financial pressures that are on. So readings, which I don't think there's a soul in the American theater who likes readings, are things that one can do when one doesn't have to apply for a grant for a particular reading. You just apply or you have money and it's cheaper to do. I would, as I've said repeatedly, love to put a 5 or 10 year moratorium on all readings and commissions and see what happens. Some people say you can't give money to writers, you shouldn't. But the way that it's working now is coming out of very real pressures that are put on theaters that have to continue to operate. And so to say blithely, you know, we need more money, I mean, I don't know who's sitting in this room, but those of us who were in Washington during the NEA wars was a fucking nightmare. I mean, there was no one in favor of supporting the arts. That's not quite true. But it was a complete failure. The community was not able to rally any success. And even things like Denver, which had that zoo tax, you know, remember that? What was that called? The arts parks and zoos tax, but the arts was hidden in the middle, so there was a little money from sales tax. That was gone. So it's not like we can look around and say, and yet at the same time, this country has a very vibrant theater. I run the Directors Lab at Lincoln Center, and I have directors now coming in who are starting theaters in parts of the country that have never seen theaters before. Where is that? I mean, there are theaters everywhere, in little, you know, Appalachia, rural Washington. So it's not like the community isn't thriving. There are people graduating from colleges, moving into theater. I mean, it's about money on some level. I don't know, you know, whether you go back to Washington and try and influence, you know, who's going to be the next NEA head, whether that's completely futile. But I think the English model is so removed from our culture that I can't imagine it suddenly being transplanted here. I mean, we have no money from the government. We only have either individual contributions from audience members, patrons, etc., and some foundation support, which is basically rich individuals.
In many ways, what I'm writing these things is basically a comparison of apples and oranges. That they're two completely.
Yes. So I mean, having somebody say I hate your play, or having somebody say I love your play, it's the person who loves your play who's going to understand you and do your play. It's when everybody kind of doesn't like it or like it that you're in trouble.
It's interesting. On this, about 5-6 years ago, when I was at a theatre in London, I was just member of the audience. There was a questionnaire that had been left for me to fill in, but audience members to fill in. How many times you go to the theatre? What kind of plays you like? What themes the plays should be? Do you like comedy or tragedy? Do you like social realism or do you like more? And obviously the artist and director is trying to do a focus group on the audience, which is my constant bugbear, because we've got to guess what the audience wants in order to fill up the housing and make money. And then we're going to obviously find the writers to fulfill all those criteria.
Good luck.
That is tomorrow, I think.
Absolutely. What would you say?
Well, I'm kind of interesting. Hybrid, because I'm a dual citizen, I'm Irish and American, and so I lived there, and it's one of my favorites, so yeah, I'm a dramatist there. And I find it really, and I saw movies a lot here before I got into the dramatist, and when I go over to Ireland and get actors from Abbey, ask them to sit around and do a reading, and they look at me like, and are we going to get a first reading? Money ball, and no, we kind of do it. And once I got them the idea through their head, which they hadn't had before, they were so into it, and they were asked for feedback. They know that I wanted to talk to them instead of the actor being told, you know, they get a part, and they do the part, have any part of the development, it was an exciting thing for them. And I feel like, in some ways, the American kind of playwright, being a theater here is vocation, and over there, that can be a job. We don't even consider, as a player, I never personally that it could be a job here, but it has to be something that I need to do no matter what. And I think that there are benefits on both sides, but we're so accustomed to not being supported. But on the flip side, because we don't have the Arts Council here, you can ask them to come in. And they will throw in.
A lot of people
So I think what happens a lot is we don't have those systems in place. Like the idea of philanthropy for a small British company in London, you know, I live in a small area in South London, and I'm sure there are people in the area who would like to contribute to the British company, but it's such a bizarre concept. And even the approach, to know how to approach those people is just a whole other world to me. So I think one reason why we need to kind of work that out and work with various different things to actually get my head around this, is this concept of programming seeding, the why you just see them if you go to the UK, people want to take money. Because a lot of times, because you don't get asked for money, you don't have the structures in place, where they go, okay, I'm going to do a Kickstarter, or I'm going to, go to our patrons and say, hey, we're going to get £10,000 or whatever, and go, yes, you'll come to a car on the night, and those systems are creeping in now. But the danger of relying on all kinds of funding, don't get me wrong, it's a blessed thing, but the danger of relying on it, which we now just got into, is that when we don't get a project involved very quickly, because we go, oh, well, and so with my big something, we need to be fundraising events, from gig mics and coming up to raise money, actually, we have money for the fundraising events. And now to watch the theatre, but it's only now something like around actually going to international money, which is like a great joke.
I have a couple of business questions since we're talking about money. As far as the Arts Council is concerned, how does its funding happen? Is it voted by the Parliament? Does it come out of the Prime Minister's office? How does it come about each year? What is the capitalization currently, let's say the last year if you know it? And from that capitalization, Is it like a fund, and then the money is basically invested, and they send out a percentage of that to theaters around the country? How do they choose the theaters that it's going to? What amount can a theater depend on? How does the whole system work?
So do we have private knowledge about this? I only know it generally, but this is, I have to tell you what I know. In terms of where the funds come from, the various funds, government overall, but there's also funds from various districts, various parts, I'm not sure the technical name happens to be, because there are several theaters we know in London that get really a lot of local funding, sort of neighborhood funding, as well as Council of the Arts and that sort of thing. The other piece that I know about that, or that I've read about at least, is that different than the American model, where the amount for the arts is sort of has to be run through Congress and that kind of thing. When you're talking about the amount, the history in the UK of how money is spent, then the baselines are quite different. And in some of these studies that we looked at, yes, it depends on a certain degree of success and a certain degree of ability to attract various audiences. And now, one of the problems with the Arts Council is that they are looking at the whole country rather than the theater centers, say. And so a lot of money is being spread in the Midlands, for example, that was not done before, which lowers the amount that's in London, because like everywhere else, you looked at London and said, oh, well, London is getting a huge, overly large chunk of what the total funding was. And so that's been changing. And I'm not an expert, and certainly we have not studied that carefully. But
There's no, you have to take into account really what the history of the country is. And when you think that, for example, Shakespeare seems to be as alive today over there as any of the contemporary writers, the history of money supporting theatrical production is wholly different than in this country. Even the national playwrights, you think Eugene O'Neill or something like that. Eugene O'Neill doesn't attract money the way that some of these British writers, in Shakespeare being the best example, do. And so there isn't a national sort of conspiracy to fund arts.
But the business questions are terrific questions. I don't know the answer. It may have had to be
Most of the arts council's funding comes from the national lottery.
So the national lottery contributes
to the
arts.
Yeah, the national lottery is basically established. And please excuse my knowledge of this is very rigorous. I'm going to stress that, of how in fact it works. But the National Lottery was begun to subsidize the arts. That's how it happens. In terms of how the funding is distributed, it's all arms length. The Arts Council is not the Department of Government. It is an agency of the Department of Culture, Media and Sport. And it has local arts councils, Arts Council for London, the Arts Council for Leeds, the Arts Council for Onwich, practitioners and peers sit. So it's absolute arms length. However, having said that, there have been recently a series of cuts which jeopardize particularly regional peers. But that's another story.
But I think every time you talk about a funding, you know, how money is spent, there is an agenda, and you can, there's an answer to your question. I mean, there are lotteries in this country that fund the arts in different states. We have federal money, we have state money, we have city money as well, although it's much reduced. But when you say at arm's length, I mean, each country, obviously somebody decides who gets the money. And when the NEA was set up, and you know, one used to do panels, there were so few theaters in the country that the panels would go visit all the theaters and write reports and look at the previous reports and say, oh, this theater looks pretty good in Chicago. So it was that small. There are now so many theaters that there's no possible way that anyone, they can't even be visited. They've completely gone out of the business of even trying to visit them. So everything has to be done, again, on paper, which is obviously no way of funding anything, because you only know the theaters that you've actually seen, the theaters that are in Creed, Colorado, what's there? You're not going to get anything. In European countries, you have, like France and in Germany, you have the additional thing that, unlike this country, where every year 10,000 young actors descend upon New York to make a career in the theater, let alone playwrights, designers. Everyone is siphoned off in their education very early on. So you have to apply to go to conservatories when you're 18. If you don't get one place at the conservatory in Strasbourg or Paris or whatever, you don't go into the theater. The wonderful life of theater people in Germany is because 98% of the possible people were shepherded out of the business at 18, and those who managed to stay in have a job for life. That's not how we do things in this country. Anybody can join Actors' Equity, and most of them do. So what the result of that is you have a lot of social engineering. Like in France, the subsidy is high, and they will decide, again, it's who knows the Minister of Culture. The Minister of Culture is appointed by the sitting president, so when the government changes, the minister changes. And then they'll make decisions, like we're going to move all the major administrations and theaters into the suburbs. And so you have these, you know, it'd be like in the National Theater, you had to go to, you tell me, some completely you know, an hour outside of London that you can't get to with a taxi, you can't get to on a subway. That's what happened in France. The NEA panels in the old days, they used to give you a list of states that had not received NEA grants in the last 5 years. They were usually North Dakota, Oklahoma, and they would say, give money to these states because all the money is going to, you know, to California and New York and Chicago and Minneapolis, you know. So it comes with a certain price. In Germany, you know, you have these very autocratic, lots of money in Germany, but very autocratic organizations where certain favored directors are given oodles of money to run certain theaters, in some cases deserved, in some cases not. But it's not at all something that the public can vote on with its feet to say, I support this theater. It's done by fiat, by a sort of in crowd of other artistic directors who say, we like him, let's give him Munich. And then you get $20 million from Munich, which is a completely different way than we do business here. But it's a good question because it reflects, you know, money reflects power. And I don't know who sits on the Arts Council in England, but it's, you know, whether it's theater administrators or whether it's politicians or whatever, but it's somebody. And
there's a fair component of arts. Right.
To Robert's start point about cultural differences, I just wanted to point out that this country was founded by the Puritans who shut down the theaters for 18 years. You know, and so there is a fundamental difference with expectations on a cultural level here.
And the whole sexual equality, which is what drove the Puritans crazy, is what drove the NEA crazy.
Yeah, exactly. It's not in the audience DNA. It's just not in the audience DNA here.
To do what?
To go to the theater. I mean, just the number that you said of people in London who didn't consider themselves involved in the theater, but who went to the theater. And especially, I don't know what it is over in Britain, but the pressure now for younger artists to go into film and TV to make any kind of money at all. And I'm sure writers are feeling the exact same pressure. It was always bad, but now it's really getting out of hand, where a lot of times younger actors are not working with. It's funny, I always love going to Lois Wilson play here in town, just so I can sit in the audience with black people. Or if I go downtown to one of the small theaters, I love it when I'm not just sitting with kids that are just graduates from NYU or very accomplished. That there, even when you go to the theater, you start to recognize, oh yeah, that's the Roundabout crowd. Oh yeah, that's the Manhattan Theater Club crowd. If you can start to recognize audience faces, the pool is not wide.
Yeah, and yet it's why this anecdote, Annabelle, young folks going to places where there aren't theaters and founding theaters is very heartening to me.
Yeah.
I mean, in Philadelphia, there are 95 producing theaters. When we moved there in the fall of 1990, there were 25.
And at the Theater Hall of Fame the other night, Michael Kahn was inducted, and he said there are now more theaters in Washington, D.C. than in Chicago. So it's a huge theater town. And, you know, Smash is a big hit in America. I mean, I think everybody is interested in theater in some strange way. It's not like it's completely gone out. But I don't know, are you guys aware of the fact that an agent in an agency now gets a statement at the end of every year, right at bonus time, that says how much money they've brought into the agency? Now, that's a new development. And so how much are you going to push your clients to work at, you know, Theater X when you can push them to work at Pilot B.
Exactly.
You know, that's a new development. And if there are actors in the room, you know that, you know, you're on a pilot and you're on call for 4 years without even being asked to allowed to read the script. So what can you do a play when you have to be sent to Hollywood at a moment's notice to shoot? You have no control of your life. I mean, these are all new developments.
There's a theater in London, the Finra, that I think the stage is probably as big as these two rugs.
Seriously?
And it seats above 60 people. And it's non-union. Now, that's a mixed bag, really. And I talked to union, the head of the actor union, and just about the situation. And of course,
here?
They know there.
British actor.
British actor. And they're not happy about that circumstance. However, they're also not in a position to do anything about that. And no salaries, officially, no salaries are paid. It's a very, very good theater, actually, and they do terrific work. However, it's, you know, for 60 people, it could never, in fact, support itself as a professional theater. They do wonderful work, and actors who are members of unions, etc., can work there. And there is, as far as we know, no repercussions. And sometimes, you know, an individual company will do a play there, and what they'll arrange is, from company coffers, they will give the actors car fare or something like that. It seems to me extraordinarily healthy that something like that is possible. Because a lot of people get seen for the first time, and when we were there, we would almost never be there without there being agents there. Looking around at plays, looking around at actors, in some cases the design yourself, though in that size of space, the design is strictly minimal.
The problem is with that, in my experience, you keep doing that. Writing with nothing, acting with nothing, just because you want it, and then you forget, like, well, you're talking about it, it's got to be vacation, and you forget to learn a living, or have a life, it's great, but you can just...
I think it's an element in the ecological landscape, but it will suck us dry if it's the only one.
And you look in the audience, and everyone in the audience, and all your friends, and all of actors, and writers, just supporting each other. Yeah, but it's, I mean, I don't know anything, but I know it's similar.
That's how I do something, is we can only raise a certain amount of money. We get Arts Council funding, 10 grand, we raise 6 grand ourselves, but our budget's going forward. So we pay our actors 150 pounds a week. We give our gestures with the actors and everyone, but we can't actually afford to do anything else. You know, the young actors within our show has been nominated for Best Act, we offer send awards and the directors. You know, so the experience of those people in that scenario, you know, is absolutely fantastic. So obviously, I would love to have an extra contract and be able to pay my own wage. You know,
sure.
I have. But without kids doing that, these experiences don't happen, especially the eyes of the people on the young actors that are constantly. So they get those experiences. But it is that kind of, like the sense, that sort of scenario where you don't catch you with that to be completely acceptable.
Yeah.
Because it's not.
Because then
we'll
be
like, oh, it's
nothing
for our
life.
Yeah. But I think what's great about your article, and I think what was really remarkable about Outrageous Fortune, is that I don't think anyone is happy with the situation the way it is, and that's a really good thing, because theater has to keep evolving and changing, and other strategies need to be used, and so the discussion seems to be a very a very fruitful one, to throw out other models, other opportunities. I mean, the worst thing is if the thing stays in a static situation as history moves on. And I don't think there's anyone in the landscape that says, this is working for everybody. I mean, it's working for really not too many people. And so it has to continue to have ideas thrown out. And that's what's exciting about hearing what's going on in England, and trying to figure out, you know, ways of change and institutional change and change in actual, you know, process. I mean, the bottom line is, yeah, there is no change in process in the sense that you want a production. The work that you do happens in rehearsal. But how you pay for that production, how you gather the people to make that production, who's in charge. I mean, there have been wonderful developments. I mean, playwright-run organizations like 13P, I mean, that's an idea that hadn't been around for a while. Steppenwolf was such a one when it first began. I mean, things emerge. So I think the more discussion, the more ideas will come out, the more people will try, and funding will find and support those ideas. So it seems a fruitful thing to be doing at this point. If we were all happy, there would be no reason to be saying it.
You know, I've been struck by, like, I'm thinking about, what's the name of the theater? It's called Tooting Arts Club. Tooting Arts Club.
Oh, Tooting.
Well, I'm using the animal, not like right. Tooting or Tooting. Yes, Tooting Broadway. Yes. And I'm reminded, as I listen to you, Anne, of tiny theaters that started in Philadelphia that I, you know, initially just didn't pay any attention to, that have stuck around and have grown and are doing some of the most daring and interesting work and are becoming players. And because I suppose we've all been in these conversations which are inevitably and necessarily laments in some ways about money. I would like to spend a little time before we say goodbye talking about some of the success stories, even if they are success stories in spite of. We got an email. The author asked not to be identified, but there are some good questions in this email. Whose efforts are actually generating playwrights and plays that we remember or we will remember? From our efforts, what are the plays that resulted, that thrill us, that are our babies, that are going to go on? And I would love to hear a few of those stories tonight before we say goodbye. Because even though there's absolutely angst, aggravation, fear, too many works that don't get heard, and too little money, etc., there are success stories.
I just saw that weekly conversation on the rec play for the Boundary Theater, an incredible production of the TMF. And the rec was chosen for the playwright, but what they did with it was outstanding. It was the kind of theater that makes me happy.
I would say Irene Furness. I would say Irene Furness.
Yeah.
Anybody ever remember Irene and her playwriting workshops? I mean,
we started out with yoga.
A powerhouse of writers that came out of that workshop, and her methods, which were incorporated here too. You know, should those be published? Should those be brought back in some way? Forget about Irene.
She's fantastic.
Of course.
Chino Nights still, the Rising Phoenix Theater doing the Chino Nights, even their one-night productions that they do a week full production and it goes up for one night. And they're...
A week's rehearsal and then they're up.
And you know, they make them happen. And it's in, I think, Jimmy 43's back, the back room of a bar, and they make it happen. And to me, it's like one of the most beautiful things. It's exactly what you're talking about. They're doing it for the actors, do it for free, everybody donates their time, and the plays are really rather incredible.
I just wanted to do
moved back to the first day when I came from New York, I went down to LA, and I went to a theater called Theater of Note, and all we did was movie plays. And, people spend their things here, and, pretty good. Playwrights have been working in New York, made you recognize, you get their plays, and we were at that panel, though, because as a company member, you had to be, you knew the people inside what plays got produced, and you had to have at least three people read the same play, and if it got two thumbs up, it moved on to the next stage, and, that was all individual taste, but it felt like a big part of, you felt like a part of you, probably, whether that's a good thing or bad thing, you guys, Playwrights, because I know all the kinds of new things to come into, but, it was creative process, and they'll make two things like that,
since we're here, the new dramatists. I mean, the library here is without that, there's so many plays that I wouldn't be able to read at all. I don't think for Kate Fodor's RX, I don't think that is actually published. Yeah, but I was able to come in here and read it, and so it's really a great resource.
Yeah, 62 years old. It's great to see it thriving. Yeah, just the fact that anyone can come into the library and read is a wonderful reminder. It's not quite funny to play, it can be the world premiere, but it's pretty good.
It has a sense of community here. Some of us who've been around a lot of time, you have to be fantastic. It's part of the fellow sufferers and then go.
It's very good.
You were saying there's a national studio. There's an organization that's just begun in the last couple of years in London called the Antelopes, which is an informal gathering of mainly London playwrights, although some representatives, you guys spoke to some of the members. It's a forum for new writers, only playwrights, to speak and to share.
The Antelopes. There was a group here in New York. They were called the Aardvarks, was it? I think it was the Aardvarks. Model on the Antelopes. And they met informally for a while. I mean, if you haven't heard of them, you probably drifted away. But I think it was the Angels. The Antelope group is interesting because they, on the first, three writers, David Eldridge,
Duncan,
and one other, I can't remember. Anyway, they thought it would be a wonderful thing for the London writers to get together in a up above pub and meet occasionally, not every week, but occasionally, and just talk about both, talk about plays and talk about how to get your work done and sort of share ideas on that. They thought when they sent out a word to a few writer friends, the room was not this big, it was a much smaller room, and what if 20 people show up? First meeting, 140 people showed up, all playwrights, and all people who, really wanted to talk about how to get plays done, how to encourage more writing opportunities, how to handle budgeting problems, because even with the Arts Council and money going to some theaters, it was extraordinarily difficult for most of them to ever get a production. And that organization, to the best of my knowledge, maybe you know more about this than me, is still going. And there are...
there's about 600 who are on the apparently a listserv, and you need a password in order to get in and have the conversation. We didn't get that. But we did hear some of the watchwords of that organization, or the manifesti, which really came down to, this is overgeneralizing a little, but it's David Eldridge, one of the founders, and really a well-established, mature career writer. Not so known here, which is interesting, but really amazing, really amazed they got there. So writers were turning in very rough drafts of scripts because of this kind of insidious process of, well, everybody's going to want to get their hands on to tell you what you do. And so I would say the key manifesto of the Antelopes, as I understood it through David Eldridge and reading some pieces about them, was you only send in the play you feel is ready to be done. And taking that responsibility means you've done what you can. Not that you never want to hear anybody's input, but that you've really done everything you can to feel this work is complete. And I thought that was pretty empowering.
Because the anecdotes that we had heard is that somebody, a playwright, might deliberately screw up a scene or something like that with some obvious solutions to put it in so that somebody could work on it.
Feel valuable, feel needed, you know, justify the enterprise. That happens a lot.
One of the motivating factors behind the attachment of the Antelopes was a sense that a insidious development culture was contributing to the certain aspects of British theatre, and that people wanted to have a way of getting together, being clear about what's sending to companies and how we were expecting to be treated by companies and what they could expect from the playwrights. It's a great form of solidarity amongst writers and clarity.
I mean, I think what you're saying is really important, because this whole discussion tonight, you know, it's like everyone's waiting for someone else to do it. Everyone's waiting for the government to pay for it. Or, I mean, I think one of the things, again, that you can get from looking back over your history is one of the key things that happened in the new play development movement was when Edward Albee had Virginia Woolf on Broadway, which was really one of the first big new play cash cows, four character play that ran and ran and ran. And what did Edward do with that money? He and Richard Barr started, built a theater on Van Damme Street and produced Sam Shepard and Adrian Kennedy and John Guare. I mean, that was Edward's money from, people don't know this. And Bob Moss, the founder of Playwrights Horizons, was stage manager for Richard and for Edward at Van Damme Street. So it was, you know, a playwright who, I mean, there's certainly, you know, people in theater who can afford to do this without having to be an anonymous bureaucrat in Washington.
That's an inspiring success story. Yeah, and it's easy to forget.
I apologize, but I have another business question.
No, we like it.
When you buy your tickets to whatever theater you're going to, and you don't want to go to the theater box office, you want to buy them online, does each theater have its own website which sells its own tickets? Or do the theaters, when you go to their websites, redirect you to Ticket Central, as we do here, so that they don't know who's buying their tickets?
Yes, exactly. It's both. Large companies tend to have their own, but they also, you probably know more about how this works for producers, but yeah, it's a little bit about.
Because it astonishes me, in this city and in the country, why these theaters don't understand that they need to know who is attending
their plays. And by when I go to the Lincoln Center website, because I'm a member of Lincoln Center, and I want to buy a member ticket, and then I get sent over to Ticket Central, I question whether Lincoln Center knows that I'm buying a ticket to their production.
We do.
They do. So you get that information from Ticket Central.
And no, Telechart.
Or Telechart. And do all the other theaters and producers get that information?
I'm assuming, I mean, box office is just a money question. You have to put staff on it who make money every day. So it's most small theaters, we have a box office staff of five full-time people. Most theaters can't afford that. And we have 43,000 members. So we need Telecharge. We just can't afford to
Well, the reason I ask that is because then, after I see the play, I'll get flyers for the next production, right?
Hopefully.
But I notice from other producers and other theaters that their marketing is more shotguns. It's spraying very broad. They're not zooming in on me as a particular theater goer and what my tastes are in order to target me for specific playwrights, specific production, that sort of thing.
I don't know what your experience is, but we go really to external books and we'll get sent. Obviously, because we have printouts on the desk with everyone's names and their addresses and actually where their postcodes and their email addresses. So we don't have the administration to be able to filter through what you came to and what we didn't. We can just target you because you come and we'll target you again. So, I mean, and that's the big, I'm not sure any company actually will look at the specific buying habits of you know, particular.
As a consumer, I would encourage you to do that. Because when I look at the tickets that I bought over the course of the year, you know, there's five from the same theater, there's five from the same producer, there may be three from the same director. Those people should be keeping track of it.
A
lot of them actually do that. We get, or I get, on my computer at least, almost all the New York theaters that we attend, we get everything from
the
computer.
And all the London theaters we
have. Oh,
they're
yes,
definitely keeping an eye
out. Yeah.
Right.
I got one flyer once as a follow-up to a Connor McPherson play. Saw one of his plays, then I got a flyer a few months later, specific to him. And I thought, wow, that's interesting. But that was the only time. Now it's the shotgun approach. If you like, you know, Kiss Me Kate, you're gonna love The Crucible. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not
believable.
I'm sure a good designer here. We might have more than one good designer. A wonderful lighting designer was a resident lighting designer at the New Play Theater in Philadelphia. I wonder, Jerry, if you might be inclined to share, having with many new plays and many not new plays, what your stake as a designer is to the health of new plays and whether those projects are in any way more meaningful?
The stake is really a one-shot deal. I brought up earlier today a concern with new plays that doing a new play and then letting it go seems to be not particularly supportive of the new play process. And I'd say that was the one drawback of the New Plays Festival I worked for, is we would choose a slate of plays to do for a season, and we would, you know, put our all into doing that. But once we had done that play, it would have been no different than having done a Shakespeare or a Chekhov or whatever. It just, you know, went on the shelf and we went on to the next show. And it seems like there really does need to be some kind of support for new plays beyond that production if a new play is really going to thrive.
And what great, I mean, just, well, there are networks like the National New Play Network. It feels like in the last 15 years, there are organizations that are more intentionally trying to keep work circulating.
so that there, it isn't one and done.
Well, I thought the idea of doing PDFs, if, in other words, we probably can't get plays published here and everything it does
about.
But I thought the idea of, you know, because now, you know, computers are essentially ubiquitous, and the idea of having, you know, in a program or something, a little thing at the bottom saying, you know, interested in this play, you know, contact this website or this person or whatever to get the PDF of the script seems like a way to give the script a life beyond the production, since we won't be able to sell the book at the door.
I hesitate bringing this up because it's such a different model, but I studied Danish Theater for Young Audience companies, and they have an entirely different funding source and structure. So it's very, very, very different. But one thing that's kind of fascinating, and this is also from a company creates its own work, and it's almost like it's theirs and no one else does it. But the thing is that they'll do a play over the span of 10 years, they'll do that play several times. Bringing back a play is never an issue because it's considered one of their pieces.
So it's in their repertoire.
Yeah, it's their repertoire. And it's kind of a funny thing that the revival is the, you know, but it's also that element of, well, we think people will come to it. And I don't know if it's a good or a bad thing, but it's just a question. I wonder if people would ever want to, well, we'll do it this year and then we'll bring it back. I think it does happen, but I think there's that element too of how much are we connecting our identity to a work and that we really call it something like that. It's not so, maybe I shouldn't have even brought it up because it's
so different.
Well,
I think it's very, first of all, the idea of models in other countries, it's very stimulating to me. I didn't know the scene in France at all, for example. We should know this thing. Denmark, no, I think it's very interesting.
It also might be interesting to bring back a play but not a production, if you see
right.
The difference in
yes.
Making that, because bringing back production is just, you know, it's retreading something, and I would think you could potentially lose audience, whereas bringing back a reimagined version of the play seems very exciting.
Sure, but down the sales.
That's
one way not to do it. It's one way not to do it, please. I was going to finish. I had a play on in Finland, and I was completely amazed because the actors and the directors and the writers are all on the salary, government salary. There's no self-employment, there's no hand-to-mouth living. It's you do the training, and then you're a playwright, you're an actor, you're a director, and that's it. Basically, almost it seemed like a job for life. And so this sort of edge you've taken off the whole. The actual art had gone out of the actual product. I saw quite a few, and it was very casual. I'm not saying any sort of, I'm not making a judgment about all the finished theatre, but what I was, particularly the actors, they were very lackadaisical about it, and kind of blasé about being an actor, whereas the hunger was, look, your act was definitely missing.
It's
mm-hmm.
Very common. I just a point, and you talk a lot about marketing and getting audiences into theaters and selling tickets. The component of that particularly disturbs me, I know a lot of actors in New York, a lot of working actors in New York, and playwrights in New York, who don't go to the theater and don't see anything because it's prohibited. You know, and I know a lot of people who are working in the theater who don't see.
Because of the expense.
Yeah.
I mean, so what you like about something, it keeps the price down. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
At the same time, there is cheaper theater. I mean, I can't afford to go see, you know, anything on Broadway, for instance, but, you know, there's Horse Trade, there's like tons of different places that are putting on, Adam Sipowicz is the Clown Bar, $12.
That's just one sort of
yeah.
Extended spectrum.
Yeah.
I don't mean economically, I mean also, you know, I mean, you really need to see everything. You really, if you're a working writer, if you're working actor, you need to see everything.
And it's the same with training programs. I mean, the kids who are in NYU or in Juilliard, they have no time to see plays. Yeah. But I mean, if you're young, you can do blink ticks and student ticks and obviously the ticket booth, and you can sit in the second balcony on TDF and get in.
That's why I
love
not to be much more likely to go see a new play. I share one that's really kind of from that, right? Instead of expecting a crowd audience to take a chance on that, it's $80
There's also different cultures, so like Chicago has a professionals week end or something like that, where it's less reduced prices. Or I was really amazed when I went to Signature that they would have an entire performance that people could come to who worked
there. Accident theater, where professional could go to the box office, man. You know, so,
Except like the dinner menu at Sardi's in the old days. Remember that? Yeah, if you had an equity card, you could get dinner for $10 at Sardi's after 10 p.m.
One of the things about, say, the Royal Court in London, talk about a factory, and I use that term advisedly, is they're not throwing things out, they're doing first-class productions of most things, but in some seasons they do about 24 to 28 productions a year. And so there is sort of an industry there keeping alive both theater for audiences, but also they run a terrific number of actors through those programs, designers, etc. There's a lot of playwrights, both in residence and people that the artistic staff simply watching. It's absolutely lively. Now, that doesn't mean at all that every production you see there will be actually good. It'll be interesting, but maybe not more than that. But as a service to the profession, I mean, you think of it this way, that writers, yes, if the play is produced, there's an amount of money, but in fact, there's no guarantee that there will be second productions, anything. So the rest of their time, they're busy doing something else. It seems to me, when I think about this after a very long career working with writers, that something in the system needs to be adjusted or changed, because right now there are too many very talented people who get drawn off into other professions. They don't get to do what they both love to do and are often very good at doing. It's, you know, for us going over there, we've always liked London theater. But this last time we were over, we probably saw so many productions, about 60 new plays. So we were going to all of the theaters, you know, so anything which was really a professional theater, not necessarily a pub theater, although there's a lot of great theater that goes on in pubs. And what a wonderful time that was, and the number of productions that we thought, what was our ultimate count, that weren't good, it was about 6, and we saw over 50. And, you know, this country in many ways has more money, more resources, more possibility than right now any country in the world. And so you wonder about just the state of the theater. And I mean, I love Lincoln Center, and I, you know, try to go as much as I can to that theater. And in a certain way, that theater gives us a really a a standard by which to judge an awful lot of the work that's in the rest of the city. Nonetheless, looking at the total picture of what Broadway is, what you can get there, where the bulk of audiences end up, and trying to separate out which of the smaller theaters really provide a big bang for the buck. Hopefully the buck is low buck. You wonder what the next step is. You wonder whether what's going to happen here is finances will become so important. Think of it, that if you're in a theater staff, you've got a whole gang of people who are doing nothing but fundraising and or advertising, etc., doing all of those things. And then it's all focused on sort of one person whose only job that year, regardless of how well paid you may be at, say, Union Center, nonetheless, maybe the only thing you do for the next 2, 3, 4 years. Something wrong with that system. You know? Something fundamentally wrong. And, you know, what the chances are of, certainly of us in this room, but of there being a regeneration of theater as really vital, healthy, for the bulk of the population, not that small coterie of people who, if you go to a lot of theater, you see the same people showing up again and again. It's a thorny problem for this country, and of course for Britain, with government changing and different attitudes toward how hopefully the arts will be supported. I mean, that's becoming an issue there. Not to be depressed, but on the other hand, when you're seeing really terrific work by people, so wondering what the future is for these enormously talented people.
Well, I look around this room and there are definitely, you know, the next generation, and it gives me hope. We're going to count on you and we're going to count on us to support the next period. I think we're past time. Thank you all so much for being part of this.